this is going to be a bit of a spooky episode because I'm filming it right at Halloween, and I'm doing what I like to call an autopsy. So the music's going to be a little bit jiving with a spooky theme, and because we really don't know what we're going to uncover here. That's now known as the Ray Santilli hoax. A man named Ray Santilli came forward and said it was a hoax that he had created. At the time, I didn't know that. I was young. But the point I'm trying to make is that it was spooky, and I couldn't take my eyes off what was going on. Even though it was a little bit terrifying, I still had to get in there. So this is kind of like that. I have no idea what I'm getting into on the inside of this creature. And I've never rebuilt a Mopar engine before, but I've done 3 Chevrolets, and they've all turned out pretty good. I've made a few mistakes along the way, but this time I've got, you know, a lot more knowledge than many years ago, and manuals to do the job, and the assistance of online research and good friends. The first step before I can go ahead with my autopsy on this car is to disconnect the power. So I will disconnect the battery, and I will proceed with draining both the engine oil and engine coolant. I only got about 6 liters of engine coolant out, and the color of it is kind of yellowy, so I'm not really happy about the color, and clearly I didn't get a hell of a lot of fluid out of there. So in its final days, last few drives, it did indeed lose a lot of coolant. What's puzzling me is that these heater core hoses are absolutely dry. Not a drop of coolant inside.
There is blood in my autopsy video.
It's mine.
Alright. I've got all my sensors.
Having a bit of a time getting the intake manifold off, kind of like opening up a grilled cheese sandwich. Yeah. I want you to feel like you're here with me in my garage, working with me and part of my show. So we're going to be listening to Michael Jackson's Thriller. That's a classic album of my time. And found something at a garage sale one day, Gowan. So, you know, some spooky tones there, like Moonlight Desires. And I've also picked out Bark at the Moon. So these are, you know, 80s albums. And I wouldn't say that I'm an audiophile because, you know, I'm not that hardcore. But I think collecting vinyl is also fun. And it's kind of cool when you get to hold a big image of an album you like. You know, some people argue that it's not digital because it's not a bunch of ones and zeros recorded and computerized, that it's actual pure audio on a piece of vinyl. So there's a purity to listening to vinyl. I just honestly think that it's really cool. I'm bagging and tagging everything as I go along, labeling things as I go. I want to remember what goes where, what tools to use to put it back together faster, and I lay everything out nice and clean and in the order that it came out, so that when I go to put it back together, I'm not looking all over my garage for the pieces. You can see that I've still got the hood on. That's because I'm working by myself. I don't want to take it off and scratch anything until I get an extra pair of hands in here. There doesn't appear to be anything wrong with my water pump, but I'm not going to chance reusing it. Look how dirty my fuel pump is. It's not supposed to be black. That's just all road grime and oil residue, grease. It's been a long ass day and I'm out here. Just cleaned up my fuel pump. See how good it looks? And that's really what takes time here. When I put my Hooker Super Comp headers on, my oil filter didn't fit anymore, so I had to get a shorter one. And as a solution, what I've seen a lot of guys do and what I'm thinking about doing is, instead of putting an adapter that angles it off, I will go ahead and mount a remote oil filter location and probably put one that holds two filters, and then I'll get probably a little bit more cooling as a bonus and a little bit more capacity and even better filtration. And it's not very expensive to do, and it'll sort of be a nice investment to protect this engine that I'm really working hard on to build. It was a Fram PH16 that actually fit. Okay, so check this out. I've got no more push rods or rocker arms on this engine, so in theory the valves should all be closed. And when I go ahead and I rotate the engine, I end up with this crazy huffing sound. All this wiring that I have here, there's evidence of melting on the corrugated sleeve. It looks like someone used something like hockey tape and patches of electrical tape. These wires are old and brittle. I'm going to redo the whole thing, and it'll be soldered, heat shrinked, weather tight, modern connections, and I'll do that, and I'll also be repainting this firewall and the inner fender. All that's going to get redone while the engine's out and have space to work in here. Another thing you probably noticed is the bracketry on this car. There's a lot of it that looks to be sublime green. Obviously this car was pieced together with donor parts from another Mopar. And even so, I believe those parts are supposed to be black from the factory. So as I'm going along, all these parts are going to be stripped down and redone. If you look at how fugly these pulleys are, you can see that I definitely need to spend some time with the bead blaster. Strip them right down, primer them, repaint them. I'm going to pay special attention not to blast in the grooves and chew up some belts in the future with them. So there's going to be a careful restoration back to the factory black. So I'm super excited to get these heads off and have a look. My head bolts are behind my header flange, so I won't be able to take it off until I get these headers out of the way. And there's literally no movement there. And I'm gonna have to crawl underneath the car, disconnect it at the collectors. Funny, I didn't know this, but I actually blew out my header gasket. You can see some openings right through. All my head bolts are out, and I've got my pry bar because I don't think that this is just going to lift off. Just as I suspected, I've got some dished pistons in there that are low compression ones. Cylinder walls, they actually see some sort of crosshatch look to them, which I expected they would be really, really smooth looking. This head gasket, oh boy. I'll take it off and have a closer look at it. I would like to know what the bore is on these cylinders as well. If you look at my valves, especially the number 4 cylinder, looks way different. Looks like it was very hot, in my opinion. You can see a lot of the head gasket stuck to the head.
My bell housing is so covered in road grime and grease that I can't even tell
where the bolts are. Well, I can tell there's one there. The other side also has one valve on the exhaust port that is not like the other. It's pretty frosty looking.
Didn't have to turn a bolt.
Yeah.
There she comes. Okay, I'll just rock the back a bit more.
Yep, that's good. We're totally clear, hey?
Yeah, now we don't have to index the hood or find a spot to put the hood or nothing. And that means we can put the engine back in the same way.
Last time I pulled an engine on a dart, my grandma, so I was like 15.
Yeah.
I was on the end of a 2x4, my dad was on the end of a 2x4, and my mom, and we set the block right there. And then we, it was all done with a 2x4, man, a short block like this. I don't think we never pulled the hood either.
Nope. Clear, huh?
Sweet.
Half a liter per side. Uh-oh. It's gonna fit. Just enough.
Flip her over.
Ooh.
You can see the vertical lines right there. Try to shine the light a little bit there.
Yeah, those ones maybe. You can't feel with your nail.
Yeah.
But this one you can.
It's hard to see, but I'll try to show you. But the connecting rod is off to one side on cylinder 7. The connecting rod itself might even be bent. But if you look closely, you can see that it's not centered on the piston there.
Do you want to look at the...
Would you find this angle?
Other side's the same way.
Yeah, all the other ones are centered.
All the other ones are centered except for 7 and 8. They seem to be offset for some reason.
Yeah.
Oh, we just found a smoking gun here.
There it is. Wow, look at the gouging in there. Would they have to sleeve that? I don't think you can machine that out. That's deep.
Jeez, that's at least 30, 40 thou on one side. So you'd have to go 80 over.
Look at the gap there.
To get it out.
Whoa.
Gapper.
So maybe I use my other block.
I think this block might be f***ed. Because if that's if you take 40 thou, say, on a feeler gauge on one side, you got to double that to get rid of that. So you're 80 thou.
Then you end up sleeving it if you go too far, right?
F*** me.
But yeah, look at that pin.
This wrist pin totally slid.
Totally out. Does the rod look bent if you look at it from a different profile? To the eye, I can't tell.
No, but the cam bearing showed that it probably is because it's worn on one side.
Yeah.
Or not the cam bearing.
The rod bearing.
Rod bearing, yeah.
I mean, it's truly exciting when you get yourself deep into an engine, literally. I consider the pistons to be the heart of the engine. And when you get in that deep, it's kind of exciting. And it's kind of parts that you don't see every day when you tinker with your car. So my friend Crockett found something that I didn't find. And I think he found it because we had the engine in a position where it was actually able to be seen. When I was looking at the engine in the car, the piston was already all the way up. And I wasn't able to see that gouging in the cylinder walls. And when we had the engine upside down on the stand, my friend was able to spot it from the backside. And it was caused by this piston pin that is pushed out on the side. So imagine how hard the engine had to work with that kind of friction going on, that kind of loss of compression going on. That explains some of the excess heat that I would have had. It explains the lack of performance, and I really don't know how long it would have lasted had I not even taken this engine out. So the beautiful thing is I have a spare engine. I got this from a friend, DJ. he had it, and so I bought it as a spare. And it turns out that this engine is exactly the same engine as the one I have, except it's already bored 30 over. And I'm going to have it checked over professionally, and I'll probably have pistons installed by professionals so I don't end up with the same kind of problem that I just had. It's not really a good idea for a do-it-home job to put your own pistons on your connecting rods, so I'm going to have a pro shop check my rods, make sure that they're the proper length, and install the pistons properly for me, make sure that my bores are perfectly lined up and squared, probably change my cam bearings, and then I can take it home and do the easy assembly myself. I think I'm going to end up making some sort of lamp out of it, or one of those steampunk things, or just a pretty cool keepsake as a souvenir to put on my shelf. I hope you stay tuned for what comes next. This engine bay is going to get cleaned right up. I can't go ahead and sand it and repaint it until I get all the oil and grease and grime out of there. And then this is going to be made all like new. My engine that I have is going to be totally redone. So there's going to be an assembly episode, and there's also going to be a break-in started up episode, and I filmed an episode on Fords actually, so there's going to be some other cars that aren't just Mopar showing up, some more special guests, and as soon as the snow's gone, I'll have a lot more action shots and events to show you, and that's when the show's really going to start getting exciting, so please stay tuned.